Our special guest today, Sarah Nurse, who might just be the best women's hockey player on the planet. Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show, coming up! Our guest today hails from Hamilton. She went to the University of Wisconsin for 4 years, winning 3 conference championships. She was named an All-American with the Badgers, a gold medal winner, 2018 Under-18 World Championships, a 2-time gold medal winner at the World Women's Hockey Championships, the 2018 Olympic silver medalist with Team Canada, 2022 Olympic gold medalist. She holds the Olympic scoring record. She stole the show with the NHL All-Star Game festivities. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to the program. Sarah Nurse. Sarah, great to have you here.
Thank you for having me. Hello.
Well, I know it's been a whirlwind 13 months or so for you. The line that came to mind was from Zoolander, "She's so hot right now." There's so much going on for Sarah Nurse. You were busy, and I appreciate you taking the time to join us here today. I want to start with you talking about your family. Of course, with your dad, Roger, who I know is a great lacrosse player. He refs lacrosse. Actually, he refs with our pal, PJ Fox, and they ref together. And tell me about the influence of your dad on you and your brothers.
Yeah, I would say that my dad had every single influence on my brothers and I growing up in the sports world. He always taught us like the value of hard work and determination and being that 1% better every single day. And so he was the one that really instilled that competitive drive within us. And like, I owe so much of who I am as a hockey player, but also a person to my dad for sure.
Now, also, you know, your entire family, I mean, this is crazy, but there's so much athletic influence there. Your cousins, of course, Darnell Nurse of the Edmonton Oilers, Kia Nurse, who is with Team Canada, UConn Huskies. And I looked at the birthdays here. So you were born in January of 95. A month later, Darnell's born. And then a year after that, Kia comes along. And I understand that you got a pretty proud grandmother.
Definitely. Yeah. I mean, there was a lot of chaos in that, you know, 13 month span that we were all born, definitely in our house. But my grandparents, like, they still print out every newspaper clipping, like whenever we're going to be on TV, they're always tuned in. And so my grandma Nurse is absolutely one of our biggest supporters, biggest fans. And my late grandfather as well could not have been more proud of all that we've been able to accomplish. And I'm just so grateful to have people like my cousins, like my brothers, like, you know, my dad, my uncle that I'm able to pull their experiences from, and also just have as a support system. So it was awesome to grow up in the Nurse family.
Well, funny you mentioned your uncle. Of course, your uncle, you have two of them that are well-known. Your uncle, a Syracuse star who became Philadelphia Eagle, Donovan McNabb, 6-time All-Star with the Eagles and also played for the Cardinals, I believe. Your uncle, Richard, receiver for the hometown Ticats. Now, tell me, has Donovan got over that Super Bowl loss yet?
I don't know. You know, it's one of those things that he had such a successful career, and you know, unfortunately, Super Bowl just evaded him. And I even know that when the last Super Bowl went on, like, I was cheering for the Eagles just because I still have that in my mind. But again, like, he was such an awesome influence. And I was young when he was still playing, but I definitely got to experience some of the games. And I saw how he trained and how he conducted himself over summer training and things like that. And so he was so awesome to look up to. But I actually realized a couple of days ago, it was my Aunt Raquel who actually, that's who married my Uncle Donovan. They both went to Syracuse. She played basketball. And she was really somebody who I looked up to so much because she was this like beautiful, intelligent woman, but she was also like a rock star on the court playing basketball. And so she's somebody who I definitely looked up to as well.
Yeah, Roxy, college sweethearts from Syracuse. That was a match made in heaven, no doubt about that. But when I was referring to those Super Bowl loss, I was talking about this year's Super Bowl loss and that lousy call at the end of the game. That one stung. Yeah, I know Don lost in the Super Bowl, but he must be pretty upset about that. But yeah, I made the assumption that you guys were Eagles fans and, of course, Ticats fans because, you know, Uncle Richard. So tell me, how much of an influence were all these people on your, you know, your you talk about your Aunt Roxy, and you talk about the Don, and you talk about growing up with these athletes like Richard around you, and that's not the kind of place that most of us grow up in. And tell us how with such a positive benefit.
Oh, sorry, you just cut out a little bit. What was that question? Oh,
okay, so I was talking about, so you grow up in a unique circumstance to have so many elite athletes around you. Tell us how that was, you know, growing up compared to, say, me, who didn't have that kind of influence.
Yeah, I think that everybody's upbringing is so individualized to them. Like, I look at some of my friends who, like one of my friends does a lot of theater. And so like her family, they had a bunch of people who were within the theater. Like she had an aunt who I believe was like on Broadway. And so I think that everybody has those influences. It just happened that ours was sports. And I think that, you know, when I saw my cousins doing something, you know, they're playing soccer, I want to play soccer too. And so I don't think we ever directly like competed with each other, but I think that we used each other as motivation. Like I saw Kia or Darnell doing something really cool, and I wanted to do something really cool. And it's cool to kind of see, we kind of have three generations of grandkids in our family. And so we've all grown up, gone through university. My little brother's at the University of New Brunswick right now playing hockey there. I have another little cousin, Alexis. She's at Syracuse. She's on the basketball team. And then I have a cousin, Jojo, who's coming up playing hockey. He's from Houston, Texas, plays in Buffalo. But it's kind of cool to just see the influence has kind of trickled down over like 30, 40 years. And I think it's been something that's pretty special. But I definitely think that sports was just something that was ingrained into us. And I think that a lot of other things are ingrained into a lot of other families as well.
Talk about your decision to choose hockey. What was it about hockey that made Serenurs think this is where I want to go?
Yeah, I think I definitely had some gentle nudging from my dad. He absolutely loved hockey, and I think he identified the skill that I had. I was always a very good skater, and I picked it up pretty naturally and effortlessly. And it's something that I just really love to do. And I grew up, I played all other sports growing up. I played, you know, soccer until I was like 16 years old. I did basketball. I did volleyball. But at the end of the day, hockey was the one that I loved the most, that I had the most fun with, and that I was the best at. And so I think a little gentle nudge from my parents, but also my love of the game, my love of skating really shone through.
Well, it's, you know, when you're good at something, it does inspire you to want to pursue that kind of that kind of direction as well, though. Off to the Stony Creek Junior Sabres, Provincial Women's Hockey League. You set a scoring record, 36 goals, 56 points in the 35-game season, capped by a hat trick in the final game. That sounds Wayne Gretzky-ish. Pretty impressive. Yeah.
Thank you.
So,
yeah, I mean,
go ahead. Finish that thought. Yeah.
No, I mean, like growing up playing in Stony Creek, it was awesome. I had a lot of great teammates, but also great coaches who, really pushed me out of my comfort zone and made sure that I was a good teammate, a good all-around player. And so although I was scoring a lot of goals and setting these records, I think that I owe a lot to my coaches, Stacey Marnock, Glenn Bowles, who definitely taught me how to be the best teammate possible and the best all-around player.
Why did you choose Wisconsin?
I chose Wisconsin because I wanted a big school. I wanted to go to a school with a huge athletic program, and I wanted to sit in a class of like 600 people and just be a number. I didn't want the professor to know my name, know that I played a sport, anything like that. I wanted to just experience that big atmosphere and be, you know, like a little fish in a big pond. And I had so much fun there. I don't regret my decision at all. I'm biased, but I tell anybody, if they have the chance to go to Wisconsin, go, because it's the best place on earth.
Hey, well, you did pretty well there. You you went to the Frozen Four. You got a marketing degree, won three conference championships. Must have had a pretty good team. Also named All-American. Tell us about that honor. And that's
yeah,
a nice
that
move,
was something
by the way.
Pretty. Thank you. That was one of my favorite goals. Actually, I scored in my entire career, but. Being an All-American was such an honor, and it's something that at the time, I'm trying to think, I don't have my facts straight. I don't know if Kia ended up being an All-American in her senior year, but At the time, I was the only one in my family to actually be an All-American. And so that was like my claim to fame. I had a couple academic All-Americans in my family, but never through their sports. So that was kind of a little fun fact of trivia that I got to bring to the Christmas table. But again, such an honor. And I was able to play with such incredible players. We had great teams. My coach, Mark Johnson, he obviously is an absolute legend in the States. And so playing as Badger at Wisconsin, again, was incredible.
Well, academic All-Americans, that's interesting because they were pretty good athletes as well, right?
They're pretty smart.
Yeah. So a few years ago, you're named to the national team, and your cousins were asked, I think, by the Toronto Star at the time, about your success and your rise to prominence with the national team. And here's what they had to say. Let's play that, Vic.
I sent her a text message and like just mind blown. And I think it was like a half hour after it had come out, and I was looking through the Snapchat, and it was Canada, Team Canada Snapchat. And I was like, oh, wait a second. So absolutely incredible, beyond proud of her. You know, she might be the first family member to bring home a medal. And I'll be more than ecstatic to see that.
You know, it's for us as a family, we're really excited to watch her play. And you know, wearing that Maple Leaf, there's no greater honor, especially playing this sport. And yeah, can't wait to see her out there. I know her offensive ability, her instinct, and her hands. I think those are probably her strongest suits. And it's good I got the defensive side of the puck, and she's got all the offense. So it's like I said, she's an exciting player to watch, especially with the puck and her ability to make plays and see the ice. So that'll be something to see her compete at that level and have the ability to play with the amount of talent that they have on that team. It'll be a lot of fun.
Well, he nailed it. You know, the offensive, the vision, the hands, you know, we saw some of that goal you scored earlier. But, you know, you got the silver medal in 2018, and then you got the gold medal in 2022. And your performance at Beijing really was otherworldly. You set a record. And the opening goal from the gold medal game was an absolute beauty. Claire Thompson with the beautifully done. Your fifth goal of the tournament. You had 18 points. That is a record for single Olympics. So were you surprised that you were able to pull that off?
Yeah, that's definitely not something that I set out to do. My main goal was to actually just be on the ice. I was coming off of I tore my MCL in October of that year. So that was my first game in about 3 or 4 months, I guess, at the Olympics. And so my focus was actually just to be on the ice and to make an impact however I could. And as the tournament went on, you know, I had a hot stick. I'm playing with great players. I felt myself being really fearless and just attacking and seizing the day. And so I think back to that Olympic performance for our entire team. There were, I think, 3 or 4 records broken. Claire Thompson had most points for a defender. Like, she smashed that record. It's not even close. Brianne Jenner, I think, tied the record for goals. Marie-Philippe Poulin had the record for scoring in every gold medal game. And then our team as a whole, like, we scored 57 goals throughout that tournament. And so we were flying on all cylinders, and it came down to us just trusting the process, trusting our preparation, and trusting each other. And I think that our performance, like, it still gives me chills thinking about it and talking about it, but it was an absolute honor to be on that stage and to play on that team and to bring home the gold medal, because that's something that we've always dreamed of. We've always wanted to do. And so happy that I was able to do it.
So you were the first in the family to hear the, you know, the Canadian anthem sung at the Olympic Games. And how did that feel?
Oh, incredible. There's no better feeling than knowing that you were literally on top of the world, that you are the best in the world. And so we waited 4 years for that Olympic gold medal, and it was pretty sweet. I was hoping that maybe the NHL players would get to go, Darnell, maybe join me in Beijing. And I'm looking out for Paris, that Kia can get on the podium as well, because, you know, there's so much success in the world, and why not all of us have it, right?
Well, Kia should be next. They got a pretty good team. I want to talk about, you know, your role models in terms of hockey. We had Cheryl back. Who are some of the role models that you've had? Haley wasn't on the show, but she's been a great role model for women's hockey, obviously. And she had an interesting tweet I read today. But anyway, it's some people out there that have paved the way for you guys, and who do you?
Yeah, I think growing up, we didn't really get to see women's hockey players. Obviously, we saw them at the Olympics once every 4 years, but I didn't really connect with many of them because we didn't really get to see them. And so now, as an adult playing hockey, there are people that I definitely look to, like Jana Heffert and Cassie Campbell are two incredible women, pioneers, trailblazers for the women's game who have, you know, evolved from being hockey players to being broadcasters, to being on the Hockey Canada board, to being the head of the PWHPA. And so I just look at those women and seeing how their evolution has helped them continuously change the game well after their playing careers. And so those are two that I definitely look up to.
How have you been affected by either sexism or racism? Or have you? Have you noticed them?
Yeah. I mean, I've always been othered ever since I was, 4 years old, 5 years old, getting into hockey. And one, because I was a girl. And then two, because I was like the little biracial black girl. And so I've always experienced that. Why do you play hockey? Why are you here? And, at first it was like the little boys, mostly parents, actually. I had a really good experience playing boys hockey. The boys were like my brothers. But it was a lot of parents being like, this little girl is beating my son at hockey. And so there was a lot of hate coming from that. And then as I grew up, started playing girls hockey, I'm the only one who like looks like me on my team. I didn't play with another, non-white player until I was on the Olympic team with Bridget Laquette, who was the first Indigenous player to be on the women's national team. And so I had never experienced that. And it was amazing to be able to be on a team with her and kind of share experiences and have somebody who like felt understood you. And so as I see the face of our game changing, you walk into rinks and you see people and children from who look differently. It's not all little white boys who are playing hockey. There are kids from Asian descent. There are black kids. There are brown kids in hockey arenas. And so I think that that's incredible. And that just shows that, our culture is such a multicultural society. In Canada, we're very multicultural. And so I think that our national sport should definitely reflect that.
You're and Drew McGinley both on the show too. And I posed a question to them and I asked them about, how color of skin affected them as they were on their journey. And it seemed to me that there wasn't that much issue from a team sport. Let's play some of that.
There's still room for improvement and they're still working away at it, but it's a great game. And also a locker room of a hockey locker room is made up of so many different nationalities from around the world. And it's part of what makes it special.
Is that your experience too, Grant? Is that, the game was special in a lot of ways and that you didn't experience, it sounds like neither you nor Jerome experienced a lot in terms of, the racial issues.
No, I mean, we were pretty fortunate growing up in Canada and playing in Canada where you don't see a lot of it. And the fact that in Edmonton, when I played, we had different nationalities there. We had Czechs, Finns. So it was a diverse locker room. And we were taught right from the beginning that it's family. So there's no colors in family. It's just family. And that's the way we were treated. That's the way we treated it. And that's the way we were brought up. So for me, it made it a lot easier. And some of the guys like Willie, Val James, Mike Barson, Bill Riley, guys like that, had to go through a much tougher time where I think I was pretty fortunate where I walked in to a great locker room, one, and a really talented locker room. So that's all anybody saw is that we were winning. And being a goalie, you're behind a mask. So that probably helped a little bit as well.
Does that assessment fit for you, Sarah?
I guess I think that everybody's experience in hockey is different. And I look at it from a lens of, I look at myself and I have a privilege of being a lighter skin complexion. There's also colorism within racism. And I'm not going to come on here and say that there is no racism in hockey because that's simply not true. But I also understand that my experiences are going to be different than Jerome's or Grant's or, you know, one of my friends, Soraya Tinker or Blake Bolden, because we all do look a little bit different. I look at my friend Blake, she's a little bit darker skinned. And so her experience is going to be different than mine. And I think that's important to understand too, is there's a different level of experience. And there's also intersections, you know, intersectionality is a big term that people should definitely research if they don't know what it is. But being a woman, being Black, being gay, like there are different things that intersect when you are a minority. And I think that's definitely important to understand. But at the end of the day, I do believe that people's experiences are different. And for me, my experience is personal to me, whereas other people's experience are personal to them.
Right. Well said. Women's hockey. Is it women's hockey in a good place right now? Tell us about that organization. And is there conflict with the PHF? Is there any kind of anything? Are they working in sync here?
Yeah, for us with the PWHPA, basically we formed 4 years ago because our league folded and there was no professional hockey in North America that we could play. And so understanding that we want a truly professional environment, and yes, that includes compensation, but that mostly includes professional nature. You know, there's a reason that you look at guys in the NHL, the NBA, the NFL, you look and see that they have these long, so incredible careers. And it's because they have the support, the staff, they have that first-class treatment, that first-class travel. And that's something that in women's sports as a whole right now, we lack. And in women's hockey, we definitely lack. So for us, that's what we're seeking to create. We want to have a sustainable league where everybody is paid a livable wage. And you know, there are benefits, there are insurance, there's health insurance, there's injury disability, because that's something that is not seen in women's hockey at the present moment. But also like childcare and things like that. We have to understand that as women's professional athletes, we have different needs than the men. And so for us, it's all about creating that professional environment, having the marketing, having the admin, the people in the C-suite. You know, we need all of that to create an excellent professional atmosphere. And so compensation is a small part of that, because obviously you need money to live. But there's so many other things that go into a professional sports league that we are looking to create. And the ball is definitely moving in the right direction. And I think we're going to see it sooner than a lot of people expect.
Well, that's awesome. And I'd like to see a lot of people pitching in terms of helping that to reach fruition. Like the NHL could probably do a little bit more than they've actually done to this point. I'd like to see that. And it seems to be happening in soccer right now too. We've got the, you know, Canadian women's soccer team is having issues with terms of finances. They're not being supported the way the men's team were. So that is something we got to change. I mean, this is the team that won the Olympic gold medal in soccer, and you know, this, all the eyeballs in the country are on you guys when you're playing for the gold medal, on the Canadian women's soccer team when you're playing for the interest is there, the talent is there, everything's there, and we just need to see, you know, a little more support in some areas. I want to talk about the Good Deeds Cup, the Chevrolet Good Deeds Cup. Tell us about the initiative, first of all, and your involvement.
Yeah, so I'm an ambassador for the Chevrolet Good Deeds Cup, and it's my third season, actually, so I'm super excited to still be a part of it. And this year, instead of actually having one good deed be selected, we want to see the most good deeds done in the community. So we're challenging teams, U11 teams to U15 teams, to create the most good in their communities and be able to upload that on social media. And so you're able to rack up points by the amount of good deeds you do. So that can be like donating clothing, salting the sidewalk, shoveling snow, like any good in your community counts. And so that's what we're really excited about. We want to see the team that does the most good, so that they can hoist the Good Deeds Cup at the end of the season.
Right. Carry some groceries. There's some help with shut-ins. There's lots of things you can do. So last year, the Lloydminster female under-13 team, the Blazers, were named season 6 winners, made history, first all-female minor hockey team to become season champions. The 2023 Chevrolet Good Deeds Cup is open as of Friday, I believe. And This year's winning team will be awarded $100,000 to be donated to a registered charity in Canada of the team's choice and have their name engraved on the Chevrolet Good Deeds Cup. And to register your team, visit www.chevroletgooddeedscup.ca. And what prompted you to make that as your one of your charities of choice?
Yeah, I've been a fan of the Good Deeds Cup for so long. I remember seeing it on social media, you know, seeing it on TV, getting the winner being announced on Hockey Night Canada. I always thought that was so cool. And so when I was approached with the opportunity, it was a no-brainer because not only does it connect, you know, hockey to community, but it really shows kids that the skills that they learn on the ice, whether that's hard work, determination, sportsmanship, those can be applied to real life. You know, you don't have to be on the ice just to use those amazing skills. You can actually apply them in your everyday life, not only as like a grand gesture, but something totally small, something that just makes somebody smile. And so for me, that really resonated. And I've seen so much good done in the communities over the last 7 years with the Good Deeds Cup. And I can't wait to see it continue and see how far it goes.
Yeah, you know, it can't hurt to offer some good deeds to our community in terms of making the world a better place to live. That's pretty awesome, and it makes a lot of sense. So now, you're the first woman to appear on the cover of EA Sports NHL with NHL 23. I want to look at that promo.
Here. Wait, what?
Okay, Trev, stop showing off. I've got something to show you.
What is happening?
But tell us this.
Whoa, what a goal! Nice!
Another game?
So tell us about that experience. Pretty cool to have that honor, I would suppose.
Yeah, I mean, it was pretty groundbreaking. And it's something that I don't think I realized fully at the time that how important it was. When I was approached by EA, I didn't really know what it meant. They kind of just told me they would love to have me on the cover. They told me about Trevor, and I didn't know how they wanted to integrate me or how I was going to be incorporated, but they basically told me that you are both on this cover. We want to show you both as being professional hockey players on the same plane. You know, he's not going to have his own cover. You both are going to be on the cover. And so I was like, that's a really cool opportunity. But how are the women going to be integrated into the game? Because I don't just want to be on this cover and then have no women talking in the game. And so they told me how they're going to obviously have our world championship be able to be played, but also how they're going to integrate us into the hut mode. And so you can play as myself or Marie-Philippe Poulin along with like Connor McDavid or Austin Matthews, which I think is pretty cool. And so I thought that authentic integration was the most important piece for me. And I've seen such an impact on the young kids, who obviously play the game, but just being able to see a woman on the cover, obviously this next generation of girls, like you don't have to tell them that they can be professional hockey players. Like they know and they will tell you. But the young boys is really, but what has surprised me the most, because they're starting to see women in positions of power and see and understand that we can be professional athletes, we can be professional hockey players. And that's the change that I've seen. I've had so many young boys come up to me on the streets and hockey arenas and like the airport and talk to me about hockey. And I think that's pretty awesome, because they're going to be able to look at, you know, the young girl who's 9 years old, just like them, and say, oh, she can be a professional hockey player, which is something that I never had growing up. And so I definitely see the tide changing, and that cover is so impactful in so many ways.
Yeah, that's significant. And in fact, as you mentioned, that the game itself represents that, not just the cover. Now playing with the boys in the game, playing with the boys at the All-Star game, and, is this a trick that maybe you learned from Trevor Zegras, who I know is a pretty tricky guy, but this is pretty awesome right here. beating Igor Shesterkin, who's a pretty good goaltender. That must have felt pretty good.
Yeah, that was actually funny. I mean, like you go into these events and, you know, the All-Star game, it's so about the fans. Like we just want to go and have fun out there. And so I was with Mitch Marner, and we were hoping that we were going to get to do a 2-on-0 because we had a really fun plan that we were going to do, but I ended up going by myself. And one of my friends had actually texted me a couple days earlier and was like, you should do the Forsberg if you go down on a Forsberg. And so it must have been like subconsciously in my mind, because I don't think that I thought about that before going down, but I knew that I didn't want to shoot because I was like, that's not fun. Like I want to pull a deke or something. And so I just went down, and honestly, it was like a hockey brain just took over, and that's what I did. And it was funny. It worked out. It turned out to be a cool little viral clip, but you know, it's hockey. I've played hockey for over 20 years at this point. For me, going down on a breakaway, I've done it a million times in my life. And so it was an awesome event to be a part of. And, you know, to be able to say that I scored on him is a pretty cool little party trick, but it was an awesome event.
I love it. The hockey brain kicked in. It seems to me that happens quite a lot with you. That's pretty awesome. Let the hockey brain kick in. I watched an interview with you recently, and you mentioned that you're not a settler. An enlightened person that I know once said, that good can be the enemy of the best, and you're not a settler. And tell us what that means to you.
Yeah, I mean, I'm somebody that I honestly wake up every day, and this is a mindset that I didn't grow up with, but it's something that I've had to learn and almost train myself. But I literally wake up every day thinking that it is going to be the best day of my life. And I have thought, like, I've done things in my life that I've never even dreamed of. I've never even imagined. And I think it's because of the mindset of me just waking up being like, well, let's see what happens today. And so for me, if I ultimately want something, I'm not going to settle for anything less. I like really believe that like we as humans can have it all. Like I think that there's so much success in the world that if one person is successful, it doesn't mean that you can't be. Like it's an infinite amount of success. And so for me, I just think that I try to reach for the stars every day. I try to make the most of every day, every opportunity, every connection and relationship that I have, because I just believe that, you know, we only have one life to live, and so we may as well live it to the absolute fullest.
Wow. You know, I think I like to start from the premise that the universe is a friendly place, and then go from there and believe that, you know, the higher good is something that's we're working towards. And I really see that in you. And I want to thank you for taking the time from a very busy schedule to join me for this, and it's been awesome having you on the show. I want to thank you for taking the time to do this.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me.
And good luck with the upcoming World Championships, I believe, up in April in Brampton. That should be fun.
Yes. Home soil. Ready? It'll be a lot of fun. So I hope to see everybody there.
Oh, wait a sec. There is one other question I have. The owner of the Florida Panthers said he offered you a job, basically, at the All-Star game. Was this real?
Yeah, it did happen. And it came from a very well thought out, very well intended place. I actually spoke with him and also the woman who was kind of taking the lead on the project. And so I was able to speak with them a little bit about their ideas and what they're doing. They're opening up a new rink and a roller hockey rink in Sunrise. And so it came from such a good place and obviously like such an honor. And so we're going to see what we can do, but I am currently in Toronto. I don't have a job with the Florida Panthers at the moment. But again, it is such a cool opportunity. And so it was an awesome experience.
Yes. And you have some world championships coming up that you got to take care of some business there. And of course, yes, the Chevrolet Good Deeds Cup, get your entries in today, teams. All right. Mm-hmm. And you can help out as individuals as well. So check that out on the website. Thank you once again, Sarah. This has been great. And we'll have more sports when we come back.
Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show is brought to you by
Addiction Rehab Toronto, Toronto's number one alcohol and drug treatment center, saving lives, reuniting families. The only treatment center in the province to offer medical detox, treatment, sober living, and lifetime aftercare all in one place. Our unique and specialized programs are designed to equip our clients with the tools to successfully lead a life of dignity, respect, and purpose. Let us help save your life or your loved one's life. Call today for more information or to facilitate an intervention. 1-855-787-2424 or visit addictionrehabtoronto.ca.
Visit moregolf.ca. You'll find everything a golfer could need, from balls, gloves, clubs, custom fitting opportunities, training gear, valuable accessories, and some great deals. Looking for that perfect gift idea for the golfer in your life? Go to moregolf.ca today.
Mike Kosa, Swiss pick of the week. Last time on, I picked our hot toddy in the opening race of Thursday night's card. Well, there was rain, lots of it. A driving rain that made driving a sulky dangerous. Much better conditions on Saturday night, and we've got the ninth race. Ariel Hanover came from off the pace with James McDonald driving to win by three lengths in 150-1. The fourth straight win for Ariel Hanover and trainer Richard Moreau. This week, I'll give it another shot with our hot toddy coming off a strong second-place finish a couple weeks back. Bob McClure will drive this time around. I also like the 3-4-6 Exacta and Trifecta box. And for all the racing updates, visit Kosa TV on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Go to hpibet.com for your wagering options.
Joe Tilley Sports is brought to you by Kosa, Central Ontario Standardbred Association, providing a united voice for harness horse people racing at Ontario tracks. Check out your benefits today at kosaonline.com and check out Kosa TV on Facebook and YouTube for all the latest harness news and live action updates. Live racing year-round. Go to hpibet.com for all your wagering options. Become a member today and your first bet is free. That's hpibet.com.
And we want to thank all the folks who make this show possible. These friends, trusted business associates, and all-around great people. We highly recommend them all. And thank you for your support of Canadian and local sports. Reminder that the show is available on iTunes, Spotify, Breaker, Radio Public, Google Podcasts, Pocket Casts, as well as the Spanglish Network, Zingo TV, and Buzz TV Live. Also, if you really want to check out our YouTube channel, there are past shows available, weekly sportscasts, all kinds of cool segments. Like and subscribe. It's absolutely free. Thanks once again to Sarah Nurse for being on the program. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time.
Do you want to buy or sell a home? Could 31 years of real estate experience help you? Why not speak to an amazing team that loves to overpromise and overdeliver? Aldo has a tremendous team of experts on staff. They are committed to making your next real estate transaction smooth and comfortable. Call 416-GET-ALDO or visit getaldo.com.
Brian Gribben Insurance Planning, helping you solidify your financial future.
At BGIP, what we do that's unique in the marketplace is we show people how to spend and enjoy their money in their early years of retirement without the fear of running out. Also, we're able to do this without you having to change financial advisors. Please look us up at bgip.ca today. Let's book a 30-minute phone call to see how we can bring value to you and your family in your planning.
Call Brian today for all your retirement needs. We did. 905-686-5678.
MNP, a leading Canadian national accounting, tax, and business accounting firm. MNP proudly serves and responds to the need of their clients in the private, public, and nonprofit sectors. Through partner-led engagements, MNP provides a collaborative, cost-effective approach to do business and personal strategies to help people and organizations to succeed across the country and around the world. With local offices in Oshawa, Mississauga, Burlington, and more, their team is here to support you. Visit mnp.ca today to learn more.
Guests on Joe Tilley Sports receive a gift certificate from Classica Imports, top-of-the-line imported men's clothing. Check out the Classica Essential Collection now. Go to shopclassica.com.